So thanks everyone for coming out. It's great. This is the title of this discussion, teach-in, is Art Between Activism, Solidarity, and Critique. Really looking forward to talking about those things with all of you and with Hal and Matt. So on that note, I think it is only appropriate to begin a day of action, and specifically a conversation about art and activism, with a comment on inaction. Speaking at the Museum of Modern Art in April 2015, the French Moroccan artist Bouchra Kabili succinctly stated her position on the possibilities of art itself as follows. "I don't think art, quote, I don't think art can change the world, but it might propose other perspectives," unquote. This was not a cliched expression of quiescence. Kabili's work is what many might call political. She was speaking in advance of the exhibition of her video installation at the museum the following year, titled Mapping Journey Project 2008-2011, consisting of narrations of forced human migration across the Mediterranean under conditions of profound geopolitical violence, voices speaking against their own erasure. In other words, to set her terms of engagement, she articulated a distinction between change and stasis, and so defined a specificity of purpose for her art. While I intend to mostly set aside the relationship between the imaginative space, privileged and illusory as it may be, of speculative thought, to focus on the realm of action associated with those institutions, like the Museum of Modern Art, I hope it will become clear that strategies of thought and strategies of action are mutually reinforcing, provided that one does not become the substitute for the other. Better an active thought than a passive action. Finding ourselves at the very long end of a crisis in political narrativity, the framing of quote-unquote other perspectives becomes a crucial task in itself, one that we should not dismiss for more rudely prescriptive approaches, even as we unflinchingly assess how those other perspectives are disseminated and to whom. Writing in the New York Review of Books in the dog days of December, the journalist Masha Gessen articulated the perspectival terms of the media's ability to counter Donald Trump's real politique of untruth. Quote, "The media have to find a way to tell the media have to find a way to tell the bigger story. The story about the lies rather than the story of the lies. And the story about power that the lies obscure," unquote. Since we are, imaginatively speaking, at the Museum of Modern Art, it might make sense to begin where every visitor begins, with a ticket desk. 8 years after its founding, in 1937, MoMA began to charge visitors admission. Today, that price is $25, a staggering 600% increase in inflation-adjusted terms. For the sake of scale and rudimentary comparison, I've placed the red line depicts the average film ticket price, also adjusted by the Consumer Price Index inflation circulated by the Motion Picture Association of America. And this is from data provided to me by MoMA of every change in their ticket price over the course of their history. those queuing for the privilege of patronizing this tax-exempt cultural institution in 2015 might have seen that price and also looked up and seen a painting by the Scottish artist Peter Doig, owned by the billionaire hedge fund manager Steve Cohen, hanging in the lobby. Cohen was then facing a civil suit brought by the Securities and Exchange Commission after the insider trading convictions of 8 employees at his $14 billion fund, SAC Capital, which would be settled the following year, barring him from managing anything but his own money until 2018, and shuttering his fund. But now, a break in the clouds and a jump backwards in time to 1969. On the left, you have a flyer for an art workers' coalition demonstration on March 30th of that year. And on the right, 13 demands submitted to museum director Bates Lowry, addressing, among other issues, racial bias in the museum's collection, reaching out to communities of color, and making the museum free at all times. And that's number 4 on the left as well, on the shorter flyer. And it's worth remembering that that the museum did institute a free day in response to those agitations. Today it's a free 4 hours every Friday. During Occupy Wall Street, the group Occupy Museums staged protests at the Museum of Modern Art, trying to revive this demand. It was not successful, and they've moved on to other things. You can see them at the Whitney Biennial, the upcoming Whitney Biennial. That sounded judgmental, but it's not. Well, maybe a little bit. The extensive imbrication of art and museums with finance capital, back to reality, with vertiginous inequality, from conspicuous consumption to so-called cultural diplomacy and endless war, is probably not news to any of you. The story of museums in the United States may also be more complicated than that, but we don't have enough gas for a detour to the 19th century. And in any case, the politics we want to deal with today, very generally speaking, begin with the birth of what Stephen Harvey and others have described as the neoliberal order in the late 1960s and 1970s, in the shadow of what the curator Helen Molesworth has described as, quote, the period after World War II, when artists came to see themselves not as artists producing in a dream world, but as workers in capitalist America, unquote. So that's where we might begin to sketch out our brief and highly selective look at the ways in which artists have used their position as thinkers, as political subjects, and as a professional class of producers to target what the mid-century critic Clement Greenberg famously called the umbilical cord of gold connecting them to the ruling class and its institutions. But first, I want to walk you through three brief examples that might expand the terms of the contemporary landscape of art and its dominant institutions and its political economies. This is a selection from the most recent tax filing made by the Solomon R. Guggenheim Foundation, the entity that controls the Guggenheim Museum in New York. It's the 2014 filing. In an appendix, the museum lists the foreign accounts in which some of its $170 million in assets may be kept. One might hazard a guess as to the breakdown of those $170 million, but one doesn't have to. But before we get to that, you can see on the bottom left here, under the name column, you have a variety of tax advantage domiciles where basically much of the endowment is invested. This is the most recent balance sheet, this is actually a museum accounting teach-in. But the thing that's really interesting about this is you can see they have about $100 million in cash and investments, liquid assets, but the art collection is booked per industry standard at $1. That's not the insurance level, but that is the way it works. The next thing I want to talk about is the use of the Metropolitan Museum by the State Department, which also has its own history, but most recently I just wanted to point to this kind of duality between, this is John Kerry speaking in 2014 in front of the Temple of Dendur, and there were several events, eventually he weakened, a senior editor at the New York Review of Books, wrote this op-ed in joining the United States military to bomb antiquities, to save antiquities, essentially. So you kind of have this sort of participation in a discourse that goes far beyond anything you would imagine a museum to generally be involved in terms of the contemporary political, contemporary cultural discussion. Then here is a very recent diary published by Francis Elis in Art Forum. He was embedded with the Kurdish Peshmerga under the auspices of the Roya Foundation and its director, Tamara Çalabi, who first came to the public eye as a spokesperson for her father, Ahmed Çalabi, a key and later disgraced figure in the Bush administration's case for the Iraq War. Elise goes forth and returns with diaristic account, peppered with the kind of quote-unquote ancient enmities nonsense that seemed plucked from a foggy bottom fever dream rather than the pages of Art Forum, an admittedly unwitting, if particularly perverse, form of apologetics by proxy. So again, another sort of unusual example of it sort of in the expanded frame of art institutions. Now to something a little bit more familiar. In the face of such vertiginous networks of power at every scale, some artists have sought simply to represent these relationships, to do, far more expansively and thoughtfully, a version of what I've crudely done with the preceding slides, to name things as they appear. This is Hans-Hakas Szapolski et al. Graphing the holdings of a very large Manhattan real estate tenant, famously caused his exhibition at the Guggenheim to be canceled in 1971. Here we have two further kind of examples of the quote-unquote paranoid style, the good paranoid style. Mark Lombardi, 1999, George W. Bush, Harkin Energy, and Jackson Stevens, circa 1979 to 1990, which allegedly earned him a visit from the FBI. He's sort of connecting the business relationships of the Bush, James Bath, and Bin Laden families in Texas and around the world. And beneath that is Waleed Rod's Translator's Introduction, Pension Art in Dubai, from 2012, which is, here we're seeing an installation, but it's also a lecture performance that just deals with the operation of a investment vehicle known as the Artist Pension Trust. And it's basically a way of securitizing art as an investment for asset managers and as kind of a pension fund for artists. And finally here, back in the real again, or even more, I guess, more real, is the designer Kim Ulbricht's Trump Connections, which was an attempt at sort of visualizing the network of business relationships of the incoming or I guess present Trump administration. And as you can see, I don't think there's a projector large enough to show its various tentacles. But there is more to arts politics than this paranoid style, vital as it may be. And unlike Hofstadter, I don't use the term pejoratively. Returning to the art workers coalition that we heard from just a few minutes ago, we can linger on the extended history of artists' engagement with the Vietnam War, which will inevitably call out similar mobilizations in the present. So here is an ad taken out of the New York Times in 1965 by 400 artists organized by a politically active yet today relatively obscure painter named Rudolf Baranek. And the basically each person signed in by sending him a check for $10, and they bought the advertisement in the Times. But what I've highlighted is the reference to the French mobilization of the mobilization of French intellectuals a decade earlier. So this is 1965, 1955. And sort of using that in the second paragraph at the very top of their appeal. To try to draw a connection and sort of link their own objections to historical ones. Moving to 1966, this is the Artist's Tower of Protest that was erected by Martin Suvaro with panels by Eva Hesse, Roy Lichtenstein, Nancy Spiro, and Ad Reinhardt, the dedication of which was attended by Susan Sontag, and eventually in 1971 it appears on the cover of Art in America. Which, of course, gives it a very particular kind of framing in light of the other highly mediagenic, maybe more mediagenic, Mars Suvaro sculpture that was at the center of Zuccotti Park. And here it is cordoned off with a barricade that was inadvertently taken from the Met. There's no connection. Someone did try to climb it, as the figures here. We're climbing, and as a result, it was barricaded off. In the Lower Manhattan Cultural Council's entry for this sculpture, Joie de Vivre, 1997, they on the online entry for it, they explain Joie de Vivre's primary red paint color took on a distinctly proletariat inflection. Error is in the original, with the arrival of Occupy Wall Street in Zuccotti Park in 2011. So again, these sort of works get variously coded and by virtue of their existence within a broader movement. So this is a purpose-built work, and this is a work that existed there by accident, and in fact, Marcus Suvaro was invited to teach it, to do a teach-in. At Occupy Wall Street and did not respond. Here again is the art strike, the organized by Robert Morris, and how we'll get into the more recent J20 art strike that sort of references this moment. So I won't linger on it too much. But it is notable to see that the Met was in fact picketed for not closing, whereas that kind of antagonism has played out differently more recently. And finally, here are the protests that took place in front of on the opening day of Documenta 4 in 1968. This was the Americana Documenta. And there were students. This depicts students waving red flags in Friedrichsplatz, and there were various artists like Wunfelstel and Jörg Immendorf who staged a happening. But I think the most interesting thing about this moment is in the preface to the catalog, Arnold Boda explained that in the very first sentence, in fact. Even this edition of Documenta, we think, does not belong to the establishment. It's not an establishment. And so there's this sort of deferral of the idea of an institution in the face of expected antagonism. And this gets us into the very last section of my presentation, which is kind of the idea of strategic antagonism, or what Krzysztof Łodyżko described in 1987 using a not problematic but nonetheless helpful military analogy. There are strategies that engage bureaucracy and still retain flexibility. One such maneuver is called, in military terminology, a wing attack. You engage your enemy in a frontal exchange of fire while part of your force penetrates a different section of the battle line. So the idea here is that artists are using, in the case of Gulf Labor, beginning in 2010, their status as artists desired by the collection to pressure the museum to implement fair labor practices at the Guggenheim Abu Dhabi. And this gesture was very specific in that it came with demands, it came with artists doing research on the ground, it came with solidarity with various New York area groups, be it NGOs like Human Rights Watch or international NGOs, I guess, in the case of Human Rights Watch, or the New York Taxi Workers Coalition. And it involved a publication in which artists generated artistic labor in the service of this cause, but it was also kind of in combination with a much broader matrix of strategies. And so to deliver in the end, via the boycott, what the artist Mariam Ghani called an engagement by disengagement. In other words, to step away in order to force a difficult conversation rather than to engage in endless, fruitless discussions. And here's Gulf Labor at the Guggenheim collection of Venice. And finally, this could also involve, and this is an important dimension of this idea of a sort of strategic activism or the wing attack, is the use of contract riders. So this is the 2016 exhibition, But a Storm is Blowing from Paradise, and 10 of the 17 artists in the show, it was a contemporary Middle East show, released a statement sort of urging the Guggenheim, at that point the Guggenheim had cut off discussions with Gulf Labor, urging them to go back to the table, but also many of them had appended riders to their acquisition contracts, insisting that the museum clear with them any exhibition of their work outside of at any satellite Guggenheim venture. So again, here you have the trying to get into the contractual basis of the art market in order to kind of force a particular agenda. I have some additional BDS stuff that I think we can get to in the end, but I'll pass it along.
Okay, so I will be brief. I think most of you know some of the material that I will present. In early December, an anonymous call for art strike on Inauguration Day in league with other J20 demonstrations and in solidarity with the women's march the next day began to circulate on eFlex, Hypoallergic, and other websites. where it was widely discussed. Graphics that echo the 1970s artist strike against racism, sexism, repression, and war, it urged individuals, galleries, museums, art schools, and other cultural spaces to engage for the day an act of non-compliance with the Trump regime. Brief letters soon followed to solicit artists, critics, curators, and others to support the initiative. Like any tactic, it explained, this call is not an end in itself, but rather an intervention that will ramify into the future. It's not a strike against art, theater, or any other cultural form. It is an invitation to motivate these activities anew, to reimagine these spaces as places where resistant forms of thinking, seeing, feeling, and acting can be produced. There was a debate about the term strike. It was decided that it should be used because of its rhetorical force and historical import, but it obviously raised questions of labor and the ability to not labor, too. It was decided to open it up to non-compliance so that institutions could respond as capaciously, as creatively as possible. At first, I was skeptical of the anti-fascist cultural front. I thought it would lose some of our liberal friends. I also thought that it wasn't really fair to fascism. In time, the number of signatories grew and the debate in the media spread. This was a controversial moment. This was the picture that the New York Times used for its first publication on the art strike, and many people reacted negatively to the prominence of famous artists, Cindy Sherman, Richard Serra, and Joan Jonas. Some of us thought that was essential to get the word out at all and to get the attention of the media. This invitation, this call, would then be interpreted diversely. In fact, it was enacted on January 20th in various ways, from actual shuttering to pay what you wish admission, from speakouts to walkouts, from poster-making gatherings to alternative programs about artistic practice in times of political crisis. Some institutions responded thoughtfully. For example, in solidarity with the J20 art strike, the Queens Museum closed for the day, but hosted a special session for its diverse community to produce signs for marches and other actions. While the education department of the Whitney collaborated with Occupy Museums to stage an assembly with powerful statements from individual activists and artist groups most vulnerable to the reactionary policies of the new administration. Occupy Museums issued a value statement at this time too. So clearly, there was a demand for resistance already advanced by activist groups, such as Gulf, and it has intensified in the art world beyond. This is the speak out continued in the public space outside the Whitney underneath the island. On January 19th, the organizers of the J20 art strike released a further statement on influx, and I just want to underscore a few of its points now. Committed to invention and critique, arts of all kinds are essential to any long-term political mobilization. The art world is a contradictory field torn between radical possibilities and constrained limits. There's a looming presence of neoliberal oligarchs as well. I think some people figured this out. The Trump regime brings these contradictions to a head. People of conscience who work in the art world must decide how to respond to current crises that are only bound to intensify. Despite these contradictions, the art world has significant amounts of capital at its disposal. The time has come to imagine and to implement ways of redirecting these resources in solidarity with broader social movements leading the way to fight against Trumpism. So just to underscore a few of the points, again, look back at the art workers' strike in relation to the Vietnam War, recent demonstration in relation to Trump. These are some of the points. One, hold institutions accountable for their own public missions. And I want to underscore them because I think some apply to colleges and universities. If universities, museums emerge as key elements of the modern public sphere, we must demand that they live up to these stated democratic ideals, while at the same time working to democratize their own organization. Two, work to dismantle systems of oppression within our institutions. This means not only calling out oppressive behaviors after the fact, but also protesting their practice proactively through the restructuring of power and the redistribution of resources. Many are starting to ask, what would reparations look like in the art field? How might an anti-racist vision of the arts extend to a global scale, encompassing, for instance, the boycott, divestment, sanctions? Three, name, shame, and divest from Trumpists and other oligarchs in the art world. Ivanka, Munchen, David Koch, James Murdoch. Let us not forget that Trump began as a real estate developer and that the Bronx, Boyle Heights, art is strategically used as a weapon of gentrification by elites, who also proudly identify liberals. Four, connect to the new sanctuary movement. Cultural institutions could become spaces for the practice of sanctuary, protecting employees, targeted by ICE, creating hubs, mobilizing financial support, providing media platforms. I think this, well, obviously this is the most urgent call now. There'll be an invitation for sanctuary in cultural institutions that will be imminent, that will come out this week or next. Five, stand with our colleagues beyond metropolitan centers, urban centers, and red states. Will be especially imperiled. There's a museum network that's set up to reach out and to hear back from institutions around the country to develop these spaces and sites of protected civic discourse and dissent. Finally, six, collectivize resources and spaces in support of anti-fascist work, to develop infrastructures, and to, again, decolonize these spaces. What is the composition of the room? Whose voices matter in the space? Who can appear freely in public? Who gets to represent the public? How can we work together in a way that does not create the conditions that brought us to this historical moment of Trumpism in the first place? There followed the strike day of February 17th, the action at MoMA, developed by Occupy Museums. The target here was Lawrence Fink, Larry Fink, head of BlackRock, good Democrat. He was slated to be the Treasury Secretary for Hillary. He liberalized some cuts across parties, obviously. And he was also trustee at MoMA. And this event occurred in the afternoon, late afternoon of Friday, pre-day. So it intervened into this public space. Tactically, the first announcement, the first statement in this mic check looked back to MoMA as a site of artistic activism. This is, again, the Art Workers Coalition in 1970 in relation to the Beeline Massacre for Guernica, also famous instance. I think in terms of the art strike and thereafter, there were small wins, and these could be debated. This is poster. For example, the museum did a temporary rehang. I don't think this would have happened without pressure from the art strike. In this installation, the work by the Iranian artist Parviz Tavoli was put up profit in this gallery with futurist paintings. There's a painting by Severini on the left there. Some of you might know that Steve Bannon is interested in mystical futurist fascism, figures like Julius Evola. So there are all kinds of little connections and contradictions that can be pulled out of these juxtapositions. Anyway, Another example of a small gesture, but I think in the present one never knows what the future value of a symbolic gesture will be. At the Davis Museum at Wellesley College, they took down all work, or veiled all work, associated with immigrants historically too. Slide. So these are this is a sampling of what happened in the aftermath of the art strike. Just want to make a couple other points that get out. The art world is a target-rich environment. Here's another possibility a friend of mine just sent. James Murdoch is a new trustee of the Dia Art Foundation. This is a non-selfie taken at Dia Beacon in relation to the Robert Morris exhibition that is there. Again, there are connections that could be spun out here. Morris is an important figure in the development of understanding of the space of art that led to the development of understanding of art as an institution, an important political line, critique in post-war art. You know, so here, this is the juxtaposition of this anti-democratic Murdoch, Dia as Fox, in relation to Morris is somehow salient. I think Princeton University is also target-rich. This is a handsome trio of foursome. This is Carl Icahn on the left, a Princeton benefactor, a Trump advisor. There's also this handsome trio, Joshua Charles and Jared Kushner. Princeton invests with Joshua Kushner. This leads to a quick point about the vicissitudes of naming and shaming. This was very pertinent in relation to outing strategies that ACT UP 30 years ago. I do think if you launch a critique, you have to own up to complicity, and it's important, as Gramsci would say, to do an inventory of your own implications. The head of Princo Investments Endowment at Princeton is a good liberal. And in conversations with him, he's made the point that if we really want Princeton to the best, we have to be willing to sacrifice percentage points and salary and funding and programs. I think that's the discussion we should have. Very quickly, I just want to point out for the art historians here how activist art produces its own archive that can be animated in the present. This is the famous pink triangle of ACT UP that was a refunctioning, a re-signifying of the Nazi emblem for homosexuals. In the course of the fall, works like the John Hartfield on the left, which was taken up in relation to the Reichstag fire, the Nazi stage, or alleged stage, executioner and justice. For me, for years, it was a historical artifact. This fall, it really popped, as did this piece made by Barbara Kruger for a march to protect Roe v. Wade in 1989. And then just another example of artists on the right is the artist Sharon Hayes, contemporary artist, very involved in queer art, queer politics. We hear refunctions of famous civil rights statement. Lastly, I think one lesson that I've had to relearn over the last few months in relation to my own limited activism in the art world, the academic world, is that institutions will not respond except if they are pressured. And we've seen as much with our own president, certain statements he's made. These are small wins when institutions shift a little bit, but they're important wins. They set up precedents and platforms from which we can to you. So I'll leave it there.
Being parts of some of these institutions and nonprofits and politics. And the art is the subject, and mostly through my own experience, so it's a slightly different one. So Cool Canopy, we're based in New York, and we advance, quote, a model for publication that encompasses digital works of art and literature, public conversations, exhibitions, and books, end quote, which is to say we publish things online, with this on our website, also in print, create various shows, put on public programming. We are part of something called Common Practice New York, which is, just to read that first sentence, an advocacy group that fosters research and discussions about the role of small-scale arts organizations in New York City. So some of the members are Better Known, Anthology, Artist Space, Primary Information, Storefront for Art and Architecture, but also some smaller places like Blank Forms, Participant, Light Industry, Us. So, and one of the things we've done, you know, there's been talks, there's been lots of kind of internal conversations about how to, quote unquote, kind of advocate for arts organizations. But one of the things we did was this pamphlet from David Joselit and the artists Amy Land and Enzo Camacho, in which Joselit wrote a 7-part essay that kind of praises small arts organizations like us, but also then against these sorts of larger organizations like a lot of ones we've been talking about. And so this is all very well and good, and sometimes good things happen because of these institutions and their interrelations. But you know, there's a persistent question not only for places like the Met and MoMA, but also for organizations on our scale of just kind of how to be in the spaces we occupy and whether our acts suffice. Because things can get very navel-gazing and self-referential and myopic very quickly. So Common Practice is formed in part in response to difficulties of being an arts institution our scale. So Triple Canopy, like many of these organizations, is dependent on private funding from an increasingly skittish donor class, and grants from both private and public institutions like the National Endowment for the Arts, which continues to exist. We're not very old, and again, like most arts institutions of this scale, there's a certain inherent precariousness, especially around space, especially with New York's speculative real estate market and the kind of ways in which real estate works in many of the metro poles in which you barely see your nice little arts organizations. But it's still very easy to kind of bemoan our problems, to make that mistake, to become kind of a Gramscian trope, right? That, you know, to think of ourselves as artists and intellectuals and cultural workers as autonomous and independent from the dominant social group. And this isn't to dismiss outright problems we do have, the means by which we attempt to address them. So a key one, right, is paying people what they're worth, especially who do art work. So this is WAGE, which stands for Working Artists in the Greater Economy, which is an activist organization that, you know, does a lot of research and does a lot of education, but also offers a certificate to nonprofits who voluntarily offer adequate fees to artists and arts workers. And there's also, you know, as brought up by both Hal and Mostafa, there's a question often of diversity and representation, whose voice gets heard. This is dealt with to varying degrees of success. You know, most of these places are founded and run by middle to upper class white people who can get the capital, even on that scale, to found one of these places. You know, as a diversity hire, I've experienced that. But, you know, there's still kind of a rightful blunt question of whether the often ostensibly leftist practice of these institutions, you know, be it the work produced or the form of the institution itself or some combination of the two, you know, via some sort of, I don't know, participatory art or institutional critique, you know, that are often then administrative or nonprofit, I'm trying to go verbs here, but it's very easy for those things to then become funding tools, right? Whether that feels sufficient to the political moment, and especially whether the valorizing of the artists involved in the art world at any scale, including the small to mid-sized arts institution, like they're valorizing as some sort of oppressed minority group makes sense, whether much of what we do is performative politics enacted to assure each other that we, as artists and cultural workers, are doing the right thing and practicing the right politics, and again, securing corresponding funds. And there's a lot of rhetoric around that, too, that often posits that artists as a class are better or uniquely suited to enact certain forms of political change than other sorts of people. So here is Four Freedoms, which is the first artist-run super PAC. Just to read the first paragraph, we believe that artists and art play an important role in galvanizing our society to do better. We are frustrated with a system in which money, divisiveness, and a general lack of truth-telling have stifled complex conversation, which is apparently not the case with the art system. And we created the first artist-run super PAC because we believe it's time for artists to become more involved in the political process. So there's many ways in which this question of sufficiency is raised, and this obviously also precedes Trump's election, and I think maybe operating, I mean, we're all operating on a longer time scale, but something to highlight. Though things obviously also feel increasingly dire. And, you know, this is, I'm talking more kind of from a participant point of view here, and seem increasingly silly to pretend like the work we do is sufficient. The most interesting thing we can often do, it seems, and this is, I think, one of the points Hal brought up, is to kind of share the resources we have with the people we think are doing what we find to be more sufficient political work, who may have no connection to the art world and don't also make that connection easy for us to make, right? So it involves work in our part. That might be offering our space, represented here in an AutoCAD drawing, because I couldn't find a better presentation, or I don't actually can't find my photo. For meetings, you know, for political groups, organizing groups, also recently a self-defense seminar for women, for people of color, offering free consulting on things like fundraising, which is something that arts and profits manage to become very good at for political organizations and local organizers dealing with marginalized communities, or to signal boost, you know, in various ways, including, to return to this upcoming conversation with Lu Cortez, who is a youth organizer, Jessica Swenson, who's an immigration rights lawyer at, I think, the Bronx Defenders, and titles target-rich environment, which is a term used, I think, by a federal official to describe places like New York where there's lots of people who might not be documented, and, you know, as you've seen with the ICE raids recently, is a quote-unquote target-rich environment.
Just a heads up that we have 5 minutes.
Oh, sure. Okay, I'll... So, just to say that... this might be the difference between advocacy, which is something that's codified into common practices, descriptive language, and seems focused on arts professionals, and activism, which is maybe willing to let go of the need to classify everything under, you know, our art practices, our arts administrative practices, etc. There's only 5 minutes, I think. I'm just going to let that go.
I kind of wanted to push to kind of pose a question to you guys, maybe definitely here, sort of dealing with this idea of activism within the art system, but also against the backdrop of democracy, which sort of was a crucial point, and I think an important point of what you were talking about, Hal, is the sort of we're dealing with an administration. That sort of a putative populist administration is a populist without people in many ways, and that sort of when you're dealing with any kind of public-facing systems address within the matrix of like the symptoms that some political scientists like Vermeer have called for post-democracy, that that there is a sort of that an activism within mediated by institutions or coming out of institutions, even activism that's ostensibly public facing or in solidarity or going beyond the art systems, you know, as strictly construed, you're still dealing with a kind of block in the logic of mass politics to begin with. So I mean, this is sort of like an institutional failure of like such the notion of protest or like the linkage of protest to democracy, right? Yeah.
Yeah, I think that's been, I mean, this kind of symbolic nature, or the increasingly symbolic feeling nature of a lot of that. And I think it's also thinking about the Ashton Taylor piece for The Baffler about the difference, I think, between activism and organizing. Is that the dichotomy?
That's right.
Yeah, and so there's ways in which that, and this is not very popular, is this just ways in which that, like, kind of putting the Triple Canopy brand on a lot of these actions and being like, we're calling all our workers to come and strike together has felt insufficient, at least to the people working there, and offering our resources, like I said, to places that we feel like are people that are doing work. That sufficiency is a weird criteria, but I'm not sure what else to use at this point.
I'm not sure that it's a good idea to sacrifice the strike of conscience in relation to bourgeois democracy. In other words, most of these institutions have, in mission statements, an account of how they serve the public, and indeed how they support democracy. And this institution does in other ways. And that's a way in, it seems to me, to a demand that they live up to what they say they do already. And that, in the formulation of the art strike, that was much disputed. You know, some people thought that's a dead letter. It's a liberal myth that we should just give up on. And I actually disagree. I mean, for the most part, these institutions are stabbed by liberals. And this election has focused contradictions in that position that can be opened up. And I think that's a crucial thing to do. It's very, you know, gestural, symbolic, slight, but it's a beginning. I also think the whole construction of the lead institution should be challenged. That is a populist construction. I think that can be pushed back on. But sure, I think your point.
So I think on that note, we have to slowly get you guys all out of here, but there's a sign-up sheet if you're interested in talking about this more or getting more involved. You can put your name and email. And if you have any feedback or thoughts on this or the Day of Action in general, feel free to come up to either of us. Thank you, guys.
Thank you.